everybody. Raul here for Bass Musician Magazine, and today we have the great honor and pleasure of chatting with bassist for ZFG, Sam Porcaro.
Hey, how's it going?
Starting from the beginning, Sam, we always like to go back into the past. How did you get started in music and on bass?
For me, it was kind of one of those things, like in music, my parents had like me and my siblings when we were super young, start out playing piano and took piano lessons for like a year or two. And just, especially at that age, being like 3 or 4, just really was not that interested in it at all. Just kind of felt like something I was forced to do after getting home from school or something. And so after that, eventually stopped playing piano, but then always had an interest in the bass just because my dad was always practicing whenever he was home from the road. And, you know, we had his upright bass always around, and then just different basses, like whatever he was using on tour at the time would be laying around the house. And I think for bass with me, when it really started was I watched the pay-per-view event when the Toto 25th anniversary DVD came out on TV, and my dad was on the road actually. And so the rest of the family, we watched it, and I just remember watching it on like the TV and seeing my dad on stage, and they're playing in Amsterdam in this arena, and just thinking like, wow, this is the coolest thing I've ever seen. And I'd always had this interest in the bass. But then after watching that the next day, this bass I'm holding here actually. So it was like this bass was laying in my dad's room, and I went to go pick it up. And I mean, had no idea how it worked. Didn't know I had to like press down on the strings or anything. I thought you just lay your fingers over it and like press it, and like you get, you know, pull the strings, you get like the notes. So I pick up this bass and I start like just my fingers totally dead on the strings, plucking the strings, and like get no noise out of it whatsoever. And I'm just like, man, this is terrible. I'll never be able to do this. This is so hard. And just, you know, I remember just being like heartbroken that I couldn't even get a note out of it. And then my dad got home from tour a couple weeks later, and I told him I wanted to learn bass. So he pulled out, he had this old 70s Music Master Fender bass, like the short scale. Mm-hmm. And so that became my first bass. And he kind of just showed me like a couple basic things, you know, and then before he could even really give me an actual first lesson, he was back out on the road. So I just took like the couple things he showed me and kept practicing those, and then segued that into like learning basic songs that I liked, like a lot of the classic rock stuff, and mm-hmm. started from there. And then, you know, predominantly was mainly self-taught up until I was 18. From there, I ended up going to LA. It was at the time called LA Music Academy. It's now Los Angeles College of Music, where my grandpa is part of the drum department. And, you know, that's where it got more serious for me. Up until then, I was always playing in rock bands. And, you know, I always kind of thought, like, I don't need to learn how to read music. I don't need to learn this other stuff. You know, I'm just playing in rock bands. I just want to play, like, the heavy rock stuff with a lot of distortion and, you know, sit there with a pick and rock out and everything, which I still love to do. But, you know, that kind of opened it up for me, learning from guys like Jerry Watts and Andre Berry and Steve Billman, who just really took me and showed me so much and just expanded my horizons musically to the point where now my main things I love to play are like funk and jazz kind of stuff.
I don't know if everybody will know, but your dad was Mike Porcaro from Toto.
Yeah.
And it's always interesting when you have, you know, parents who are in the business, because it can kind of go either of two ways. Either one, they're like, yay, go into music, it's great. Or they go, music is a hard road. Don't do that.
You know, yeah, exactly.
Pick something else. But so was your dad. It sounds like your dad was very supportive of you pursuing a career in music and so forth.
Yeah, I mean, especially like my dad was always super supportive and just, you know, always was trying to show me, like, you know, he'd see me playing something and he'd try and be like, you know, if you play it like this, it's a lot easier, you know, like show me little tricks like that. Or he'd always, when I was like in high school and stuff, he'd always like help me tweak my sound and stuff to get it to fit a little better in whatever project I was doing or whatever style I was going for. But especially once my dad ended up sick and couldn't play anymore, then he kind of became like even more so of a mentor to me, where it was, you know, like, cause he couldn't play anymore. So I'd just sit in their room and practice. And, you know, he'd like help me go over things. Like when I was in school and stuff, I'd be sitting there with like whatever stuff I'm working on for school, and he'd have the music too. And I'd just be sitting there playing. And It would be a little frustrating sometimes because he'd get so like a little bit like, you know, I'd be playing through something, he'd be like, that's wrong. That's wrong. You know, like, but doing it, like, you know, we had a great time doing it, but it was also just, you know, just making sure I knew like what I wasn't doing right, helping me to hone it in and improve on it, you know?
Gotcha. And it's also interesting because especially with a lot of players that start with rock, if they can find kind of a successful path doing that, they won't pursue the additional education. And then they'll go through a whole lifetime. So let's say you get a band, you get a gig, that takes off, you're playing that for the next 40 years or so, and you never really had a chance to study the jazz or the other things. I find that a lot of those players will actually kind of do continued education. So these guys have been playing for 50 years, but they're still learning. Now they're working on their jazz or they're working on their other stuff because I think sometimes they're going, you know, I feel like I missed out on not getting that. But you're very fortunate that you've had both, you know, kind of the more formal training and a lot of the hands-on.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, yeah, for me, it was always, you know, especially like in high school, I loved a lot of the very, very heavy like death metal stuff. So for a couple of years, I was doing like just that kind of stuff. And, you know, eventually, like, you know, I kind of just like decided, I was like, you know, like I love playing bass. I love this music. But for me personally, like the bass playing, like of a lot of the stuff I was listening to wasn't like super interesting to me, you know. And at that time, I had one of my cousins, Miles, was living here with us, and he was listening to all this cool Brazilian world music, Motown, you know, Jamiroquai kind of stuff. So as I got older and started hanging out with him more and more and like just listening to that kind of music, you know, my ear would always gravitate towards the bass, you know, and you're listening to someone like Jamiroquai or something, and it's just, you're like, wow, or James Jamerson on bass on like some Jackson 5 stuff, or, you know. So the more I started hearing that kind of stuff, the more I decided, like, I need to learn how to kind of play in these styles and pick apart what these guys are doing, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think with a lot of those styles, what you find is kind of the accent on the space between the notes.
Oh, exactly. I mean, you know, it's like one, I still remember what I feel like one of the craziest things I had ever seen was someone put out one of those visualizer videos, and it was James Jamerson on Ain't No Mountain High Enough. And you just see like the visual breakdown of like where he's putting the notes and what he's playing and stuff. And you're just like, this is insanity.
And moving along, because now you've got all this, you've got your training and all that. ZFG, tell us, how did that come about?
So ZFG was kind of just, it was just like a totally random thing. You know, Trev and I had toured the year, or I guess a couple months before we did the first ZFG track, we were on tour with this rock artist, Diamante, because Trev had played on her record, and basically she had a 3-week tour with Steel Panther coming up, and the band had kind of fallen apart of like players she had. So they called Trev since he played on her record, and, you know, originally they had this big band, you know, like I think keys, 2 guitars, bass, drums, like all of that. And so this is like a week before the tour starts, and I'm hanging at a buddy's house. It's like 11 p.m. on like a Thursday night or something. And Trev gives me a call. He's like, hey, so I need to put together this band like real last minute, like for this artist I worked with, Diamante. Like, do you want to play bass? And then he got our buddy Jake Hayden, who plays with, you know, he's played with so many people. He plays with Beth Ditto. He's played with Dorothy. So it ended up being just the three of us, like, just within like a couple days, just learned this whole set. And just less than a week later, we're out on the road doing this 3-week run with that. So, I mean, and up until that point, I had been playing in a like 8-piece instrumental jazz funk band for years. So when Trev hit me up to do that, he's like, you want to do some rock stuff? I was like, yeah, man, that sounds like a lot of fun. So we got back from the road from that, and Trev was working on his own solo stuff at the time. You know, I went back to like doing my gigs with the band and recording and stuff. And, you know, then Trev gives me a call a couple months later. He's like, hey, just for fun, like we found this like awesome rock singer, and, you know, we want to know, do you want to come in and play bass on this track in the studio just for fun? So we went in and just like laid down this track. Like, at this point, it was supposed to just be like, let's just make one ridiculous rock track for fun, you know? And we ended up actually recording it on my dad's birthday.
Oh.
And so that was when, like, we went in and we tracked the song Wholehearted we put out. And so like after that, we just, we'd do a couple shows here and there for like a friend's birthday or something. They'd ask us to play. And like at that point we had two songs and we'd do like an Audioslave cover. And it was just, we were just having fun playing some like heavier rock music, and kind of just the reaction we got, like we kept thinking maybe we should actually do this as a band. So I think like 6 months later, we decided let's go into the studio again. Let's record like six or seven songs. And that's kind of when the band became a full-time thing. And
earlier this year, you guys were opening for Winery Dogs.
Yeah.
So being that the act that Billy Sheehan has to follow.
Man, that was, those guys were just the coolest. That was such a trip for me too, because I, one of the first things I did, like when my dad was on the road and stuff, and I was playing in my first band, it was like, I say it's a progressive metal band, but it's as much of a progressive metal band as a bunch of 13-year-olds can have, kind of thing.
Yeah.
But our guitar player gave me the two Billy Sheehan instructional DVDs. So like those were some of the first things I learned off of was Billy's instructional video, and then cut to that tour. And I'm playing before Billy every night, and all the Mike, Billy, Richie, they're all just like the coolest guys. And it was just one of those things where I'm like, how am I here? And then getting to watch Billy do his thing every night, and just incredible. Also, it's not fun as a bass player to be the guy who plays before Billy every night. He goes up there and just blows everyone away,
Looking ahead, what plans did the band? I know I've been seeing, I'm actually going to share one of the videos I saw special.
Oh yeah, yeah. We have the lyric video for that one out.
Yeah. Yeah. And what plans do you guys have for the future?
We just finished a month in Europe and have been back for a couple weeks, and just have like one gig coming up in the next week. And then in a week and a half, we go into the studio for a week to lay down like some new tracks again with this producer, Brandon Paddock, who's worked with countless artists. So we're excited for that. And I mean, we're just excited to get back in the studio. We've been working on a lot of cool stuff. Some of it we tested out in Europe and it went over great. So we're excited to just have some time after basically 3 months of being gone, just sit down and actually get to work out these tracks and get what we're hearing in our head out and record it and put it out for people.
Now, as you're mentioning, taking what you have in your head and putting it out, I'd be remiss if I didn't ask about how you get your sound and your gear. What are you playing on?
I have all sorts of stuff. My amp rig, I'm super happy with. I wanted one for ever since I first met the guys, but I just got a Ike T900 rig. And I met Thomas and Peter Paul, back when the company was still Tech Amp.
Yeah.
And just hit it off with them. I met them through David Hungate, and just have always always been keeping up with what they're doing and stuff. And then it was finally time for me to upgrade my rig from the old school super heavy head you can't carry with two people to, now my head's 900 watts. I carried it on the plane with me to Europe, got a cab from them out there. But it's just, what I love about it is super clean, super powerful, super transportable. You can carry it around with you, but the sound is just amazing. And what I really like about it is I feel like clean isn't the word, but it's more like transparent. You really get the sound of whatever instrument you put into it, which is something I love, because especially in the studio, I think I got it from my dad a little bit, where my dad would take, three or four basses to a session and see what fits the song best. Mm-hmm. So for me, I have my go-to basses and stuff, but what I love about this rig is whatever bass I put into it, I get the sound and the characteristics of that bass out, but enhanced.
And that leads us to, I'm sure, like most people, you probably have basses that are precious to you and you leave at home. But yeah. when you're out playing, what are you playing on?
I have like a couple basses that have been on every tour with me, and one of them is I've got this blue Metal Flake G&L SB2, which is basically a PJ, and that's been on every tour with me ever. And then, so that's my number one bass when I'm out on the road. And then with the ZFG stuff, because we play four string, like drop D or, the dropped tuning, mm-hmm. just for like the more doubling of like the rock riffs, make it a little heavier. So on that tour, I also have a bass tuned to D standard with the D dropped to a C. And so for that bass, I have this Japanese company, Sugi, that's built by this guy, Nick Sugimoto. He's worked with everyone from Ibanez, Fender, Gibson. You know, he builds a lot of higher end stuff for a lot of companies, like secretly under their name still. But so I have this four string from him that's like a P bass neck with a kind of Music Man humbucker in the back. That's been on every tour with me. And then my backup bass that I have in case one of them ever goes down on the road with me is just my Stingray I've had for years, which is, you know, old reliable kind of, which was great because the first tour we did in April, first show of the tour, my main bass, the input went down on it. So thank God I actually brought a third bass, because usually I've never had any issue ever. I'm, you know, when I play with like my funk band, I show up with one bass for the night kind of thing.
Pedal wise, because, and I'm sure it depends on the music, but with like ZFG, are you implementing some pedals?
Yeah, with ZFG stuff, I've got in the studio, I have a couple like pedals I'll mess around with. When we recorded one track, the producer had like an old, super cool Sovtek Big Muff that was just, I've always wanted to use one. Mm-hmm. But for live, I always have my Big Muff with me, like my bass Big Muff. I've got one of the Maleco Fuzz, like the super tiny little gray one. I love the sound of that. I got sold on that after I saw the video with Juan and Yannick reviewing fuzz pedals, and they turned that one on, and I was just like, oh my God, I need that. Yeah. But yeah, with ZFG, it's mainly the kind of like fuzz, like more distortion sound. I really dig the Aguilar Agro pedal too. It's got like a cool tone to it that's not necessarily fuzz, but it's kind of like almost more of like a saturation thing going on that I really just dig the vibe of. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then of course, like with the more of like the funk kind of like jazz, like fusion-y stuff, it's, you know, mainly clean tone, but you can never go wrong when you kick on like an OC2 or something like that, you know.
Even with the pedals, and as you'd mentioned, you like the sound of the instrument to come through. How about strings? Because those are an important factor.
Strings, I mean, for me, I have predominantly labellas on most of my basses. You know, anything I have flat wounds on, I have the labellas on. I have a couple basses where I have the super, like the joke is like the bridge cable strings, like the Jamerson ones that are like the, I can't even think of what it is, like the one super heavy duty gauge where it's, there's just no, like no relief in it at all. You know, like I put them on one of my basses and immediately like a couple hours later had to crank the neck back just cause there's so much tension.
Wow.
But they've just got, once they age a little bit, they've totally just got that Motown vibe where it's just, you put a foam mute under them and you just kind of get that vibe. But for round wounds, I have labellas on some, I've got Ernie balls on some, you know.
And looking ahead, I know that of course you guys are going to be going into the studio. Do you have anything that you think you'd like to be doing in the future, or plans, aspirations?
I mean, we're hitting the studio. Because our last EP, it just didn't turn out a way, aside from the couple songs we put out from it, it just didn't turn out, like, for the most part, where we were happy with it. So right now, you know, we just did, like, 3 months of pretty much nonstop touring. So right now our focus is, now that, like, we have a lot of people, like, gained a lot of new fans and stuff, and they're all like, oh, when's the album coming out? When's the EP coming out? So right now that's kind of our focus. But once we get that out and get something we're happy with, you know, the plan's pretty much just get back out on the road and keep touring and keep doing what we've been doing.
And if people want to know what's going on, how to stay current with what you guys are doing.
Like for us right now, we're working on building like a new website with all the current new stuff going on. And then the best place to follow us is just either Facebook or Instagram.
Gotcha.
So Instagram is at ZFG official, Facebook's at ZFG band. And, you know, anything we're doing any given day is all just up there. You know, Trev and Josh, our guitar player and drummer, are very social media savvy. So it's constantly some little snippet of whatever we're doing going up somewhere, you know.
For a lot of groups nowadays, the whole website is less of a focus and the social media is much greater of a focus. As a matter of fact, quite a few have kind of abandoned the whole website altogether and just go, I'll put it out on social media, or I'll have somebody putting it out for me. But that way, at least, you know, it's more interactive and current, you know?
Yeah, exactly. For me, it's like, I'm not a social media guru by any means, you know, so I'm fortunate in that regard that basically all three other guys in the band are really good with the social media stuff. So I kind of let them handle that, you know.
There you go. Well, Sam, we appreciate you taking time to chat with us. Folks, make sure you stay on top of ZFG's work going on. Social media will be your best bet to look at it. You've seen him here on Bees Musician Magazine.